Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Trauma Research Foundation's TRF Tuesday. This is our weekly mini workshop series from Bright Voices in Therapeutic Embodiment. If you're watching on YouTube, please hit the subscribe button. It's the way to let YouTube know that you find this content valuable and to have them show it to more people. Welcome, gang. Thank you for being here. Take it away.
Hello, everyone. We will start with a... Hi, everyone. We'll start with a sensory exercise. Okay, we'll do that first, just so that we can stretch our brains. Since I don't know where you are and I can't see most of you, I can't see you. I can't force you to stretch. So let's stretch our brains instead. Whew, I need you to type on the chat box how you feel watching this bearing go up and down. How does it make you feel? Just getting the rhythm. Okay, I'll give you music with it. Fine. Yay. Yes, please reply to everyone. Thank you. And while you're watching, can you see if you can breathe with it? Like breathe with the music, breathe with the visual. This is by a German graphic designer and sculptor, animation artist, Fyre Festival. Okay, that's appreciated. Okay. Now, try to breathe with it. You want it to keep going forward, yes. I'm going to change the track and see if it changes for you. By breathing in rhythm with the bearings, the balls. See if you can calm yourself down or zone the music out. Your body, stretch. Like really stretch it. Focus more on afraid of colliding. Oh, that's so true. That's anxiety speaking right there. Same visual. I'm gonna give you another track with it. Exhale with it and breathe. You know, I can't force you to count today, but of course you know of the counting. 4 inhale, 7 hold, exhale. I can't force you, but I think I can with the visuals. And this is a bit hectic, so let's change it. How about this? Does your view of the movement change? I change. I make it this. You don't need to answer, just feel the guide, the audio and the visual. What's in your mind? What's on your mind regarding this? But with more balls this time. What? I'll give you calming music. I'm going to guide you through this, okay? I have a feeling when I play this, I notice the brown balls. But if I play this, you'll start to feel the pink hues. Can you see how the lenses of your brain change? In this one sense, sensory input changing. While we're doing this, try to breathe with the ball. Thank you a little bit for that. when things are linear in life, you got to it is so satisfying. Liana said it's satisfying. I'll tell you why. Even if you know that the block will still fall on a line. Sometimes life is not this way. Fine. You have this. Let's try this in silence. Let's try this in silence. Do you find yourself focusing on just one ball? Do you find yourself trying to figure out how is gravity taking care of the balls and they're not falling? Do you find yourself thinking, is this computer graphics or is this real? Or you find yourself saying, is it motorized? Is it battery operated? Is it real? Or can you just lose yourself in the motion of it? Try now and then just breathe. With it. Just breathe with it. Rest your eyes. I don't know what you've been looking at the past week, but then this is a good rest of your eyes. It's a little more exciting so I can drag you out of the audiovisual stupor as we do this. And do this. Thank you. How does your brain feel? Did some rusty parts fall? Okay, I'll give you a satisfying one right now. Yay. Woo. Don't you wish life was like this? Well, it isn't always this orderly or this symmetric, but oddly satisfying indeed. Exactly. I'm going to stop the video now and you come back with me. Come back. Can you feel part of your brain a little more alert or a little more restful? Or I'm not sure what the word is, but can you tell me how does your brain feel right now? Oddly satisfying. I so wanted to show you one more satisfying thing. Look at this. Yee, so nice. When you're having a really rough stretch, few minutes, I really encourage you to also make the internet your friend. Now, these days, as an introvert, it's, oh, thank you for sharing that, Tracy. As an introvert, Tracy says, it's a little bit too much stimulation for me. How about if it were just the visual or just the music? Are you okay with that? Is it overstimulating when it's both, Tracy? I'm just curious before I proceed. That's all right. You will get it there. I think what I wanted you to experience with the exercise is that we always think the internet is the devil. Is it okay to say that? But I honestly think there are things that we have access to that you can actually add to your mental health first aid kit, like visuals like these. Look for psychedelic graphics. Just go on Google and type out driving in the rain and you'll figure it out, or et cetera. And so when most of us don't have the rigid, rudimentary Buddhist way of staring at one point in the wall and reflecting in silence, we can really let music and visuals help us. Everybody exhale. I like the figure eight with the golden handles. Yes, it does. I kind of like how I would always try to figure out how did they figure out the velocity so that the other hook can actually catch it and it won't fly out, etc. So let's start with tonight's topic. I am super famous for not sticking to the topic. So your first lesson tonight in mental regulation is enduring someone who's not sticking to the topic. Not to worry. What do we search for to find the visuals? Oh, I mean, I'll send you the name. Sorry, let me just go ahead and type it out so that I don't forget. Vanerstedt is an artist, and that this is his specialty, graphic arts that make you. So let's start with a movie. This, I don't expect that all of you have seen The Godfather, and we will not exactly talk about the film because you have, you can Google that. But I need you to know that let's stick to certain films that are familiar to us to get to know the family roles. I have a feeling many of you know the family functions. You probably Googled or watched YouTube videos on it. And the fact that you are on TRF's email list, I imagine you are way more, you're not on a 101 level. I don't need to introduce, but let's go ahead and try to cover what we can from picking up. Everyone has a family tree, and it varies, of course. And whatever your definition of family is, whether it's chosen, friends, etc. I really, there's a fascination for blood connection because of the genetic learning. And because as mammals, we really like to know where we're from and who our parents are. I get it. But as you get older, and I'm quite sure all of us in the Zoom room tonight agree with me that it is really ties that bind us that we now have to constantly redefine family. Does this make sense? So that's one. But there's always a family tree. Sometimes it's too painful to trace it. Sometimes it's you're edified when you trace who your ancestors are. And sometimes you're just crushed when you find out who they are. But it's always, I think, a formidable, what is the word, exercise to get to know your family tree. I think this is a sore spot for elementary school teachers. I'm not sure what it's like in the system from where you are, but in the Philippines, they always have a hard time with letting students draw their family trees because of the ever-changing setups of family, and they don't want to, I'm sure you know this, but I think in mental health learning, in the space where we are, I think whether it's painful, difficult, ugly, terrifying, edifying, comforting, I think it's a worthy exercise to figure out where we're from, whether it's genetic or chosen. So this is the family tree of the Corleones, which is the family characters in the Mario Puzo classic, The Godfather. You may disagree with me, but you know, for now, let's just use the word classic. And I really wanted to pull out family roles from this movie. There is always a scapegoat. In my opinion, watching The Godfather, the scapegoat was always Carlo Rizzi, the son-in-law, or Fredo. The scapegoat is someone who's kind of always made, their role is quite light in the family. In fact, they can be the brunt of jokes. If you're thinking, oh, that's probably me, I want you to suspend first your definition of that. So scapegoat would be not the golden one. And then there is the golden child. The golden child is not necessarily the most excellent child, but it's easy to conclude that the golden child is the excellent child. But in many definitions, in fact, I think in the strict definition of it, the golden child is who most resources go to this child, whether it's time or flute lessons or whatever. There was an investment on this child. And there are many reasons why you are the golden child or why you're not the golden child. Usually it's either by gender, like you're the only son or you're the only daughter, or you're the child that looks most like the parent that chooses who the golden child is. So if there's a parent in charge, or if they're both in some households, there's one parent that's actually bestowing all the roles. And for some, it's the fathers, and some it's for the mother. Usually a golden child can be the one that looks most like them or the gender they share. Either way, if it's a misogynistic, this is so abound, usually the boy is cherished. But in some, it's if the mother is in charge, then there's this golden child. Now, the golden child is not always at an advantage. Usually these are the ones who are stuck taking care of the parents after all, because they're the favored ones and et cetera. And if you are the scapegoat, there's a big chance you see the golden child as from another team, like they're with team parents. So they're usually isolated from the rest of the siblings. There's an invisible child. There's no picture, get it? So there's an invisible child, and it's exactly what it is. Usually the ones that fly over, the space and the consciousness of parents. Of course, if you're an only child, it completely changes the formula. Handmaid is the one that does all the chores. And usually by default, they're the ones that pick up the duties and etc. So when there's a picnic, they're absolutely in charge of making the meal plan. I don't know if it's because they're the most responsible or that's just the role they take on, or they stepped up to it so they have more relevance because they were possibly an invisible child. Does this make sense? Yes, a family member can play both roles. Layla, or is it Lila? I was just about to say that. You can be two or three roles, absolutely. What usually doesn't combine, though, if you're the golden child, you're not the scapegoat. You're usually not the scapegoat. But if you're the scapegoat, you can certainly be the handmaid, and you can certainly be the fixer. The fixer is another one, and this is the one that just fixes everything, you know, from literally the furniture or something, or fights. No, fixer is always the one, hey, he didn't mean that, or hey, mom, she didn't mean that, or etc. So, of course, it's not this cut and dry. There's not just five types, right? It's just really helpful that psychology did this for us, that there are like some definitions, because it gives us a schematic that's easy. It's a lot like the stages of grief. I'm sure you've heard of that. The denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. It never happens in a linear way. And those are not the only five stages. I'm sure there's other stages where I'm eating so much stage, and there's I'm not eating at all stage, and there's I'm trying to distract myself by dating too much stage. I'm sure there's 100 other definitions. But the fact that Kubler-Ross's model of grief gave us five stages, while it is not strictly just that or linear, it gives us a schematic. We can kind of work around those lines. But, you know, it's very healthy to know that it's never linear. So with the family systems, it's the same. It's not just these. But these are like the general, based on studies. Of course, these are evidence-based studies. These are kind of the rules that happen in parents. There's a truth teller. Usually the truth teller is the youngest. And I mentioned, if some of you were with us from the first class, I mentioned I may introduce myself as we go along. I'm the youngest of 10. I'm number 10. Okay, I'm number 10 of my mom. So my mom gave birth 10 times and I'm number 10. I know. Isn't she a superhero? And my dad has 5 kids from his first marriage. They were both widows. So my dad was a widower. My mom was a widow. They both got married. And then they had 2 together. I'm number 2 of the combination. Does this make sense? So there's yours. My mom has 8. My dad has 5. First marriage. Both spouses died within 3 months of each other. And they're all friends. So they combined the families and had 2 more babies. And I'm number 2. So you can imagine I probably have all roles as I got older. I don't know what your roles are, but if you have something interesting and you're safe and you feel safe enough to share it on the chat box, which one are you? Oh, yes, number 5. That's just kind of midway for my family. But I kept telling my mom, Mom, you should have waited for Ate, Ate's eldest sister in Filipino. You should have waited for Ate to become a gynecologist, and that would have saved us a lot of money. Or there's standard jokes in my family would be, Dad, you should have just bought an ultrasound. That would have been more cost effective. So we had our own ultrasound machine. And there was always a joke that when my mom would leave the hospital, the nurses would say, see you next year or something like that. So my mom did give birth 10 times and I'm number 10. The truth teller, more often than not, becomes the one that's estranged. I don't know why this pattern comes up, but I can surmise that it's because every family needs to kind of have a myth around themselves. Like, we are the funny ones. We are the smart one. There's a tribal team feeling within a family, even if you're pathological, even if you're chaotic or dysfunctional. Every family, by virtue of being siblings or having the same last name or being one team, I mean, we're so neurotically tribal about our basketball teams. So what more family? There are certain truths that have to be done in diagonal, dealt with in a mezzanine way because it's too harsh and a family needs to stick to a myth. Am I making sense? And do you know what I'm saying? Like, every family has its own vocabulary. It has its own culture, etc. And sometimes the truth teller is the one that sees it from a separate point of view. And sometimes it's too painful when the truth comes out. So these are the rules. I really need you. I always say this every TRF Tuesday class. the learning and the mental health motion in our brains is not happening within this 30 minutes. There's just a lot of things fed to you today, so you have stuff to think of this week. And I really want to you to think of it this week. I told you earlier, it's rarely linear. It always shifts, and it's seasonal. And Layla very intelligently asked very wise question, can I be both? Can I be three? Absolutely. Absolutely. You can have all the roles. In fact, the only children usually take on all the roles. I need you to know, who are you in the family growing up? Are you the handmaid? Are you the fixer? Are you the truth teller? Are you the golden child? Is it uncomfortable for you to think if you're the golden child? Usually the golden children come with a lot of guilt. And they are usually not chummy with the rest because they're seen as team parents. So it's really, really interesting. So you probably had a role before growing up. And who are you now? Like, did you shift? I think these are interesting questions to think of in the next week. It might be difficult to answer these two questions, which is why I need you to answer these questions in a relaxed body state. So we have guides and visuals and music, and you're very, very well acquainted with the gift that is breathing. Be mindfully breathing. And not just survival breathing, that's very different, and absolutely not short breathing when you're stressed. So if you could think about this and ruminate it over the week in a relaxed body, it might be painful, it might bring tears, it might make you happy, actually, that you have evolved, that's one. And but this is something I encourage everybody to think of. Did you have a role growing up and did it shift? Or are you still that? Or are you still that? That's one thing I really want you to know. So that's the end of the input. Gosh, I really wish we had more time because I keep squeezing everything in the half hour, but this is the space and time we're given. So that's the input for now. Perhaps some of you have questions or input. Maybe Pat can help me with stuff
People can feel free to drop any questions if they may have a chat here. I have one question that came up. Do you think people can shift their family role over time?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I think so. Let me give you an example. I'm the youngest of 10. So I was always the slowest, smallest, not, you know, youngest. But my age, okay, I'm 51. My eldest sister is 69, like almost 70, because she was like in college when I was born. You can imagine that I was the one that started with computers and she didn't. So there was a shift in role automatically when, please fix my modem. Why can't I connect to the internet? What's defrag? This is early 90s. And then how do I make a Skype call, etc. So that's kind of me. And the youngest child, and you feel, when questions are asked of you, that's a very unusual role, Pat. When you're number 10, you have no opinion. In the house, you have no say which restaurant to eat in, and we're just kind of used to it. This is why a lot of youngest children of large families become leaders outside just to balance ourselves out. We're so in charge. Other than that, we're so used to older people. So usually when we're with people our age, we're like the older ones. I think that's one. I need you to know your family role. And like I said, it's like an old neighborhood. There are two things. It's either you're too petrified to go back to the old neighborhood or you're excited to see your happy spots. Most of the time, it's a combination of both. So I encourage you to really go in a relaxed body system. Ask if you want, ask for help from someone, but ask yourself, what was my role? Did I shift out of it? And this may or may not be in a situation where you are either estranged or still connected with your family. That's completely different. But this, and I am talking about the family that you grew up with. That people who raised you, gave birth to you, or adopted you from childhood. That's where you'll see how far you've come, how far you've evolved, or what's trapping you, what's making you not move, what's paralyzing you. That these are really good questions to ask. And I wish everybody the courage and the relaxed body to take on those two questions this week. You can shift. You can also not shift. That's fine too.
I feel like I'm very much the opposite of you. I'm the oldest out of all of my. I only have one brother, but I also have a bunch of cousins, and I'm the oldest out of all of us. So like I'm the pioneer. Like I was the testes, I guess, for the whole experiment.
Ah, My eldest sister never shifted either. Like, she's the princess. She was in charge. She's in charge of everyone. She's a mom. My mom was grandma to me. My eldest sister is mom. Does this make sense? And what? Oh, she was really mom. So So to summarize, because it's a pop culture class and a multidisciplinary class, if you remember, Mary introduced that I started a nonprofit called Rock Ed Philippines because we wanted to teach social civic education through rock music. So my personality, and perhaps many of you in the room are the same, we really merge two worlds in learning stuff. So I am an art history major, which made me more civil and politically history involved because I learned it through the eyes of artists. Like, you see the world, the artists of, let's say, the German recovery system, like post-Nazi era, you see their artists different, impressionism, etc. So I encourage you to really learn diagonally or in mezzanine pockets. Pick up mental health stuff that you know. If you've studied cognitive distortions, you know what imposter syndrome is. You know, have a general idea what narcissism is or anti. Spot it. Spot it on TV shows. Spot it in Instagram accounts and say, oh, this is it. Not for judgment. Not for judgment. But of course, it's so fun to judge. Sorry. Is it okay to say that? But just for exercise your brain so that your lenses are clean regarding mental health. It also, in the end, I realize, makes us more compassionate, more patient. We give the pause button more hits this time instead of being quick to judge. We will still avoid narcissists, but we have a different take. It will not anymore come from hatred or disdain. It can come from, oh, extreme understanding, and I can't really come near this. And I must break up with this person. So it doesn't always have to be, maybe the decision, the physical behavior decision is the same, wherein you avoid and break up, but the heart is somewhere else. It's coming from somewhere else. Does this make sense? Even when you're dating a narcissist, there's just two ways. You either crash and burn, or you find a way to move away. I do encourage you to move away, but I need you to move away in the healthiest possible way for you. That you're not limping bloody out of the scenario. You're actually calmly walking away, maybe walking backwards so that you don't turn your back and be unguarded. But yeah, I think it's a different set of lens. So like I did with The Godfather, instead of just focusing on the mafia part, the macho power part or the fascinating part of crime, blah, 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 and capitalism, I really focused on, oh, okay, so this is the family role and this is what they do, etc. In the end, you realize movies aren't really what they're about. You know, movies have plots that serve as metaphors for you to pick up what matters to you and what you can learn from. You know, there's this show called Gilmore Girls. I don't know if you've seen that, but they're, it's a lovely mother-daughter relationship, and they have coffee every morning and they bake and they're funny and they're witty. And I always tell this to my patients, my clients, I say, there's not going to be a Gilmore Girls ending with you and your mom, okay? So that might not happen. Is it aspirational? Yes, but I really need us to start watching the way we watch Mission Impossible or Star Wars. You never watch Mission Impossible and say, that's my life. But sometimes when you see a realistic movie like Friends, you kind of expect your friends to be friends, or you kind of expect the person you see in the diner to be as funny as Seinfeld because they're set in a realistic setting. But you don't watch Star Wars and say, that's my life, that's me. Or you don't say, oh, James Bond, that's my life. So I need us to suspend the disbelief, enjoy the media, but also know which one is real, and it is this. And if you're delighted with it, then treat it as a metaphor instead of literally, I want to be Meg Ryan or, you know, in Harry Met Sally. I want to meet my Sally, or I want You Got Mail. I have to be Meg Ryan and write someone on AOL. Can you imagine how many crestfallen people logged on and signed up to AOL and never found their Tom Hanks or Meg Ryan? That's because we got lost in it. And yeah, I think that's the media literacy part. So approach your media scrolling with a lot of literacy and a lot of mental health literacy. And I wish you a relaxed body setting while you approach the questions. What was your role? And did you shift? And if you did, are you happy with the evolution? And, or are you just finding it a challenge to accept it? But either way, these are good questions to explore this coming week. I think actually it's a good question to explore a few months before Christmas, because usually holidays is when you kind of have to bump into them. So now it's a good time. You have enough time to recover. So yay, that's it. It's 4:34 in the morning.
For question, Mary, do you want to let us know what's going on next week?
Oh, sure. Well, thanks everyone for joining us. We really hope you enjoyed this session. We look forward to seeing you next week. We're going to do part two of the family series, and it's number 5 of 6 in this whole series with Gang. Until then, be well. We'll see you then. Bye-bye.